Okay, we're back. Episode 2 of Making the Wildcat Not Suck Again. Sorry, Nick.
What the hell?
You recall episode 1, we pulled the motor out of the cat. So we got the heads off. It checked out the cylinders at the end of that episode, kind of getting ready for our little rebuild here. So we're just going to freshen it up. We got some cool parts that are going to go on it. So we're going to start to work through that now. Today we're going to pull the cylinders off. We got some new pistons for it. We're going to give the cylinders a quick hone, start reassembling things. So Nick can be hopefully in better shape, not using so much oil the next time we go out.
Thanks, Doug.
There is so much untapped greatness in Articat. Together, MLS Power Sports and SideBySideBlog.com will make the Wildcat great again.
All right, so normally it'd be a good idea to clean the engine before you start taking it apart because you run into situations like this. We were kind of excited to see the bore, so we yanked the heads off. So hindsight, now we're just gonna try to clean around the base of the cylinders. So when we, you know, pull the cylinders off, we don't have a bunch of dirt falling down in the crankcase. We're not planning to split the cases. We just wanna put pistons on this thing, basically rebuild the top end. So we're just gonna shoot some dirt out of here. All right, so we got everything loose, so the cylinders on these are just held down by the head bolts, so we had those out already. There's a couple little 10 millimeter nuts on the side. If you got all the rest of the stuff busted loose, you'll just be able to hit that with a little rubber mallet.
Got a couple little dowels on the cylinder there, on the block, there we go.
Yep, try not to lose those. There it is.
Oh yeah, look at that.
Yeah.
How do the skirts look?
That's
everything
a piston.
Good?
I mean, yeah, there's a little.
Wow, it actually looks really clean.
A little wear on, but
yeah,
not. I'd be curious to measure them and see where they're at, but we got new ones, so.
Why does the top of that piston look so clean, Doug?
Who cares?
It looks so clean.
It's almost a little.
Like she was burning coolant.
I'd be curious also to look at a new one. It almost looks a little beat up.
Detonation, maybe?
Maybe. This hole does not look that way. It's not that clean, so, yeah.
Well, she's ran 93 all the time I've had her, so.
Could have been pulling a little coolant.
Yeah, I mean, typically when you see one that's, you know, dirty like this one, and then cleanish like this one, you think maybe it's using a little bit of coolant. So down in there, we can see the crank, we can see the rods. Crank's got a little bit of discoloration on it. I hope that's just from manufacturing things, not from running. Sure Doug can give us some more insight on that. And other than that, that's it.
Alright.
So where's the fresh pistons at?
Pop this over. You wanna see a piston?
Yeah. Heck yeah, you wanna see a piston.
This is pretty interesting. I've never bought a piston in a ring set that actually comes with the rings pre-installed on the piston. So
that's just for convenience, bro.
There's a new one, nice and clear. I mean, normally you'd like to check the ring end gap before you put them on the piston, but you know, maybe Articat says that's not necessary. Maybe they say they've gotten that, you know, all taken care of for you already. I don't know. Not sure if I trust that, but
it's part of the experience.
We'll see. So, yeah, that's a nice little kit. Comes with a new wrist pin, a couple new circlips. They ship one right on the wrist pin there. So that's not where it goes, FYI.
Yeah, doesn't it go on the outside?
Right. That'll go in here, you know, upon final assembly. But
all right.
Yeah, nice looking setup. So let's get the other cylinder off. We can
it's
pop
ready.
The pistons off there. Okay, so next thing here, we're gonna pull the pistons off the rods. This is really simple on these. The wrist pin's retained in the piston by a couple of circlips. You can pull one out either side. I guess the only warning here is to, you know, stuff the bores, stuff the crankcase, where your cam chain goes through, because these things will tend to pop out of there if you don't, you know, if you're not really careful with it. So you don't really want one in your bottom end trying to fish it out of there, so.
Let's get a little inboard view of that.
Yep, so I'm just going to stick a pick. You can see there's a relief here, so you can get a little pick or a tiny screwdriver in there.
Can't really see that, to be honest with you, but
yeah,
probably looks cool.
Yep, and that's why you stuff it right there.
Boom.
So there it is.
And the pins should slide out.
And then if everything's can be removed. In good shape, all right, the pin will just slide out of there. Sometimes it's not so easy. You got to press them out, but there it is.
Looks in pretty good shape.
Doesn't look terrible.
With a skirt wear.
It's an interesting interesting oil retaining ring on these. That's
why is that?
Not a typical like three-piece design that you see. A two-piece oil retaining ring.
Let's see what you're talking about here.
So, if you're used to more typical designs, if you've done this before, you've seen your oil retaining rings, they've got this kind of spring ring that goes in, and then there's usually two thin rings that go on top and bottom of it. This one is like a little coil spring. Got this guide wire in it, which is cool.
That's super weird.
Nearly impossible to put back together on camera. And then a one piece, or you know, the second piece that goes over top of it. So
it has like little reliefs cut in it. That's really weird.
Yeah. Cool. Interesting. I've not messed with one like that before.
Clearly works really well.
If you look at the new piston, it has the more traditional style oil retaining
let's see if
ring on it. So.
Yeah, wow, maybe, that's weird.
Maybe, considering yours is burning a bunch of oil, this is a piece of crap. It's possible.
Well, I bet that's true.
And they've updated to the more traditional setup, so.
Wow. Well, as they say, don't fix what's not broken.
Yeah, I mean,
right?
That style ring's only used in
everything.
Every engine forever.
I mean, you know, you look at...
I would definitely want to change it.
You look at small block Chevy stuff, right, as kind of like the pinnacle of easy, it's simple, and it works, and they're all kind of shaped like that. Now there is like, look at that.
Yep.
Those little oil
cutouts? Yep.
Does the other one have that?
Those are for oil, so.
I feel like they didn't have that.
It's just two, so it's updated a little. Looks like you got extra oil holes.
Yeah.
A little different shape on the skirt.
Oh, true.
Well.
This is straight down,
so.
Unless it's,
yep.
Nope.
Nope, definitely different. Definitely an updated piston. So,
how's the top look?
Yeah, top looks even a little different too.
Yeah.
There's a little less relief, a little smaller dish. A little different shape dish, anyways.
Wish we had like a burette or something. We could see if maybe it's a little bit higher compression.
CC them. We could CC them.
Well, anyway, that's cool. Updated. Maybe this will be the screenshot, the video.
That's.
Want to get in there, Doug?
That's what you need right there to get around that XP1K.
You know, we don't need that really. This is kind of meh. I think we need them ported heads.
Oh, right. Let's get those things out. Those are cool.
All right, get them. Do-do-do-do-do-do. Look at that CNC porting. Show them off, Doug. Show them the heads.
Those are beautiful.
Look at that.
Look at that. Got the valve guides all machined way down. CNC ported all the way through.
I don't think anybody has CNC ported heads. I'm gonna say it.
I believe you. I mean, I don't have CNC ported heads for my Wildcat, so.
Out of this sample size, right. My assumptions are correct.
So they're a little dirty. Looks like they were on somebody's machine and then got CNC ported. You picked them up before anybody bothered to assemble them and put them back on a machine. So we're gonna start off by cleaning them up a little bit. Then we're gonna disassemble your old heads. Reuse the valves, we'll clean those up. So you got all new seals and springs and retainers and keepers and all that stuff. So we'll put it together with mostly new hardware, lap the valves in, and should be a sick set of heads.
So what did Nick forget today? Let's talk about that.
Nick forgot base gaskets, which unfortunately comes very early on in the top end assembly process.
Pretty much the first thing you install when installing your heads.
Right, so the bottom of the motor is basically going to stay the way it is today. We're going to do the head work, try to get the new heads assembled, cleaned up, ready to go. And then after Nick gets base gaskets, we'll finish putting it all together.
All right, let's clean these bad boys up. Oh, so one big thing here too with Wildcat stuff is you want to make sure to keep your valve covers with the heads. You know, the two of you out there who will watch this video and then be doing work at some point which involves separating the valve covers from the heads. You have to know that when they machine these, they basically just send some sort of boring tool, right, down that away.
Maybe they do it twice. That's how it works.
And so when you have the surfaces that your camera is on, here, and there, and there, it's kind of all machined together. So you can't just put any old valve cover on any old head. Which means, Doug, if you break something on your valve cover, trying to adjust your valves, you have to replace the entire head.
Buy a new head. If you don't, you're gonna have a bad time.
Right.
Maybe.
So here's a first to be featured on sidebysideblog.com.
This, I can't say I'm proud of this. This is a rough old parts washer. This thing's been around a long time though. The pan is kind of bent from sitting cast iron big block heads in here. It's not really meant to hold those. So.
Big block Chevy, best motor ever made?
Not big block Chevy, no.
BBF?
BBF. So it's rough, but you know, it will roughly clean parts and then we'll do a finish clean afterwards. But so we're just gonna try to get some of this carbon out of the chambers, get a little brass brush in here, just make them look a little nicer. At least make Nick feel good about this.
Right, I feel really good. So for any of you who haven't used a parts washer, it's what, mineral spirits in there?
Mineral spirits. Wear gloves or it'll dry your hands out hardcore. It's really bad.
And it's probably a carcinogen as well.
Oh yeah.
I'm almost sure of that. It's like a toothbrush for your cylinder heads.
Little brass brush. We'll see, we'll just clean the carbon out of there. You don't want big chunks. I mean, this isn't that bad, right? You could just assemble this, it'd be absolutely fine. If you get big chunks of carbon in there, they can create hot spots, you can get detonation and bad things happening. So you gotta put a little bit of effort into it. These, honestly, we're just kind of cleaning to make look pretty for the video. But.
Right.
I mean,
talking about looking pretty for the video.
Not really that helpful.
All right, we got Doug cleaning up the head here.
Yep, so we just came out of the parts washer. We got kind of the carbon out of the chamber here. And I just, unfortunately, kind of missed it on the video, but got the gasket all off this gasket surface. So, you know, everybody's got their own way of cleaning gaskets. The way I do it when there's just a little light material left is a little bit of WD-40 on that surface and then some wet sandpaper and just kind of go through.
What is it, about 60 grit?
And knock it off. It's like 20 grit, you know, real heavy. No, I don't know what this is. A couple hundred grit, I mean.
I would think it's probably higher than that. Anyway. 320 maybe?
Sure.
Okay.
But just be a little careful. You're not gonna hurt the head doing it by hand. Light pressure. Got it cleaned up nice, so. We will disassemble the stock heads, get the valves out of them, because I think we're going to reuse those valves, right?
Yep.
And then we can put this thing back together.
Sweet.
I guess we could.
Yeah, we'll do one at a time. Let's see how pretty it looks, by the way.
There it is.
Oh.
I was just going to say we could check it to see if it's flat.
I'm not against that.
There's no real reason it shouldn't be flat, but these are precision ground.
Precision ground?
To be flat, so.
Like the beef?
That. Yeah, exactly.
Like Kobe? Wagyu?
So, yeah. You just take that flat edge, set it across the head.
Look at your arm.
The idea is, sorry buddy.
Oh, I see. We can put little feeler gauges underneath.
You can take a little feeler gauge. Exactly. So.
This is sick. What are you going to start with?
I'm going to start low. 1.5 thou.
1.5 thou, baby. Listen, 1.5 thou, bro.
Yeah, I don't have a smaller one, so.
All right.
You know, that's good. You don't. I don't know what the spec is on something like this, or if Cat's got a spec, they probably do, but. What I call automotive stuff, you know, like 1/1000th every, you know, 6 inches ahead is basically your limit. So,
Okay.
I think we're just fine here. You can check it out a couple different angles. Again, you really should not have to do this.
All right, so here's the OEM head that we took out of there. And you can see there is a lot of carbon buildup on those valves, especially the intake valves. Which means what, Doug?
That's how you raise compression on an Articat motor. You just let the carbon build up on the valves, takes up space in the combustion chamber.
That's probably why I ran so goddamn hard.
Right. So, you know, she was eating a lot of oil, so that's not that surprising to see a lot of carbon caked in the caked on the valves. That's not great, but that's not absurd either. So.
But 2,000 miles, though. If you see that much carbon build up on a car in 2,000 miles, you'd be losing your damn mind. Now we're gonna pull the valve cover off and pull the valves out. So Doug, how do you pull valves out?
I think these just unthread or something.
Yeah, I think they do. 10 millimeter, like everything else in the world,
that's
right?
That's not true. So there, you got to have a tool. Actually, these are really, there's a couple different style tools, so these ones are real easy to get at. You could use just a fork style valve spring compressor. It comes around the head, supports on the bottom of the valve, and then there's a fork, compresses a spring. There's a couple keepers in here you pull out. I've got a, you know, more of a motorcycle style valve spring compressor. We'll use that. So
this is that. Okay, sweet. You know,
take us a minute to get this set up here, but
ta-da!
Yeah, so these, you got to use these when you're using like dual overhead cam heads, where you've got a cam sitting right on top of the valves, and then there's a cup, so then the spring is kind of down in a machined in the head, so you got to have this style. But it'll work on these too. So essentially, you find your fitting that fits the retainer. That works pretty well. That'll probably work. Let's see, that would work too, but I like the bigger one a little bit better. Yep, we'll go with that.
You got that big old bar there to wrap around the head?
Yep.
Okay. Now, is this an AutoZone tool? It's in one of those red cases, Doug.
It's not, actually. I ordered this online. What's the brand? Detroit Tool.
Dude, Detroit Tool.
You know, it's probably not the nicest valve spring compressor on the market, but it works. We're not doing this every day, so.
I like repping Detroit.
Yeah. I mean, they know stuff about, like, motors and shit, right?
Right.
We got our tool set up. That's what it looks like. So you just kind of rock it on the head, and so you'll see this in here.
Presses on the valve.
Fits against the center of the valve, right? This one here goes down against the spring.
As you twist that, the spring should compress. Your keepers will pop out, right?
Yep. A lot of times the keepers will kind of stick in there, but go in there with a little magnet and grab them, which I haven't grabbed yet, but
that's okay.
We'll hear shortly.
Oh, keeper just shot out.
Got one out. There's one right there. Here's the other still on the valve. Let me grab a magnet.
There's some small keepers, dude.
Tiny little guys. Boop. So here's the other one. Two wedges, basically, and then you can unthread.
When we leave the pressure, this valve should come right out, eh?
Yep.
Now, is there any merit to checking to see if the valve is straight?
Yeah, you can roll it. You know, you get a bent valve. Usually that
is noticeable.
Will be noticeable in the way machine runs, but so we're not expecting that. So there's your old spring retainer. We're not going to use that. That's what it is. Just push the valve out.
Ta-da!
And there it is. So there's an exhaust valve. See a bunch of carbon on the face, see a bunch of carbon on the back of it. That's all, you know, pretty normal stuff, but we'll clean that up. There's some carbon on the sealing surface, so we'll get that cleaned up as well when we lap this into the new head. We'll show that to you here shortly. So basically, just rinse and repeat. If you're gonna disassemble your heads to do whatever, just to clean the head or to port them, or to put valve seals in, then you know you're gonna want to go in and number these things, put them back in the same hole. We're putting these in new heads, so we're gonna lap them all. They're gonna kind of remate to a new seat anyway, so we don't really care where they go as long as you don't try to put an exhaust valve in an intake.
Quite impossible,
right? So we're just gonna pull the rest of this apart. Okay, so we got the head pretty well cleaned up. We got the valves we're gonna use. Those are cleaned up, nice, looking decent. Kind of last step to cleaning things up is to lap the valves. So that's a process where you're just kind of cleaning the actual sealing surface of the valve and the valve seat, as well as sort of matching it to the head. So once you lap the valves in, that's going to be the time where we, you know, want to keep the valves with their mating seat. So start off, we got a little bit of valve grinding compound. You can get this anywhere, local automotive store.
I think I recall that from the Maverick video.
Oh yeah, we did use that to lap the clutch on. So we'll put some grinding compound.
Let's see how that looks.
On the face.
Okay, yep.
Just like that. Drop it in. And then this is a special tool.
Oh, what is that?
So it's a lapping tool. Again, pretty easy to find at local automotive. So that's just going to kind of suction cup to the face, and then give her a little spin.
You do that to all four valves until when? How do you know when they're lapped?
I mean, you just kind of pull them out and look at the surface of the valve. So we'll do this for, you know, 10 or 15 seconds, pull it out, clean the compound off, look at the face. If it's got a nice clean ring around the angle cut on the valve, we'll call it good. And same on the seat. If we see some spots that are missed, or if it's a little wavy, or you see some carbon still on the face, then put a little fresh compound on it and keep going.
Okay.
So these particular valves have a rough face on them, so the suction cup doesn't stick great. Got to kind of keep them cleaned.
Here's what he's talking about, by the way. If any of you guys watch Abe, focus, you fuck! It's not working. Anyway, there you go. Doug Lapperfield.
So, pop that out.
Woo.
So, I don't know if that's easy for you to see or not, but there's a ring around the valve that's a little bit lighter colored.
If it would frickin' focus, it'd be so cool, probably. Not focused, so, not a big deal.
Anyways, that's looking pretty decent. The ring where it's contacting the seat is in the middle of the angled face, which is good. That's what you want to see. So the valve's not terribly worn out. Looks like we got the carbon off it. Hopefully we see the same type of thing on our seat.
I focus on that a little bit better. Oh yeah, see, it looks clean.
That is looking pretty good as well. So these should lap in pretty easy. So there's one valve. Three more to do, then we'll do kind of a final clean on everything, lube the valve stems, and assemble it for good. There it is.
They're looking beautiful, bro.
So, we got them all cleaned up, we got the valves lapped. So what we want to do now is just do our final clean before we actually assemble everything. So,
okay.
Final clean, right? You can do it a lot of different ways. You can
spray clean.
It, yeah, spray it all day with brake clean, with carb clean, wipe it out with rags, do whatever you want to do. But my belief, something I was told by an old engine builder a long time ago, is that you just can't beat Dawn dish soap and some warm water. So,
ooh.
Warm soapy water, we got that right here.
Oh yeah, I thought this was our bubble bath for later, but I guess not.
Well, that could be. So we're just gonna give this thing a dip, shake it around a little bit.
Are you Fonzie from Dip Your Car? Give her a dip. This is the pearlescent bubble coat. Available at dipyourcar.com. I'm Fonzie. You don't have quite the what is it, vascularness that he has?
Oh yeah.
You know the kind I'm talking about.
Not just popping. So
I think you could beat him in an arm wrestling match though.
I'd give him a run.
Okay, let's see it though.
We'll come over here to the clean water.
Not so clean anymore.
Give her a rinse and that's it. So I'll hit it with some compressed air just to get the water off it, and that is a clean, ready to assemble cylinder head.
Can we just see those beautiful CNC ports again? Oh my god, twist it a little bit
Check
downwards.
Check that out.
Oh, the air is going to go in so smoothly. And just horsepower and disappointment is going to come right out of that thing.
Right, that comes out this side.
Okay, so we're going to see the underwater angle of Doug cleaning these beautiful valves. Okay, so I think we have a problem seeing underwater with the light, right?
Yeah, I think we need more light. We need like a light that we can put in the water.
Dude, fuck, I have a light on my phone. Yeah.
Perfect. All right, drop it in the water.
You're working on, Doug?
All right, so we just cleaned the head up. We got there's one more little valve seal in here we're gonna get rid of. So
the orange thing.
Yep. So the rest of them were already discarded. So these just pop off. Work it around. Don't pry on the sealing surface. on the mating surface.
Yeah, I see that.
So, okay, there it is. So that's the last old piece of junk valve seal.
So hope we got new valve seals.
We got new valve seals. We got lots of new parts. So thanks to our friends at MLS Power Sports, hooked us up big time and all the stuff for Nick's cat here. So what do we got? We got valve seals. We got bearing retainers. We got valve springs. We got valve seats in here somewhere. Spring retainers.
All sorts of goodies.
All sorts of stuff. So, a bunch of new hardware we're going to put in these things and make the cat great again. All right, so we're reassembling here. First step, you've got a spring seat that goes on the head that the spring seats into. So, drop that on over the valve guide for those guys. Sometimes you can do this after the valve seals are on. Sometimes you can't. Depends on the style of the valve seal. So,
why risk it?
Right. Here's our new valve seals. As you can see, they're just, you know, rubber. They got some ribs in there. They just push on over the guide. So
let's get one of those up real close. I'm curious.
Okay. So just set that on there like that. Give it a little push, a little wiggle.
Booyah. Is that it?
Yeah, that's all she wrote. Just like that.
Good shot of your hair there, by the way.
Oh, nice.
The ladies are gonna love that. Hoping we can get it to man bun length, but
I mean, I'm pretty against that. So
seems like
this
it.
This is about the limit for me. It's driving me insane.
But his girlfriend likes it, so he has to keep it low.
So you got all four going on right now.
Yep, there's the last of the seals. Just be careful, you know. Don't smash them. Don't bend the little springs.
Right. Clean valves are clean.
Okay, so we're going to start dropping these in. I've numbered these things now since we lapped them already. So this is number one, and just my system is 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is an intake valve. I like to use a little engine grease on the assembly of these things. So again, ask 100 people, you get 100 opinions on this. I mean, a little bit of motor oil on them, probably just be fine. But this is fresh. It's going to take a little while to get, you know, oil pumped back up into the top of the motor. This is going to set for a little bit, probably before we get it running again. I don't want the oil running off, so just a little bit of grease on the valve stem.
What kind of grease is that?
So,
not that it matters, really.
Oh.
It disappeared. Disappearing
grease. So it's engine assembly grease. Lubric plate number 105. This stuff has been around here for years. It puts so many motors together with that crap.
Lubric plate's good stuff.
Yeah. So there you go.
I didn't see it. Let's see it. Show the people at home.
A little grease. I mean, that's a little excessive, but, you know, it's not going to hurt anything, so.
Ooh, slider in.
Okay.
Doesn't hurt anything until it eats away those beautiful valve seals.
Right. Yeah, this is the acidic style of engine assembly grease.
So. Hydrochloric plate.
Okay, so valve in. We got our seat. We got our seal on. We need a spring. We got a new spring from MLS Power Sports.
Yeah, baby.
Okay, set that guy on there.
So you do it kind of sitting up like that.
That's how I do it, because you got to put the valve spring compressor on, right?
Oh,
so
yeah,
forgot about that. That's the easiest way to use that tool,
okay,
in my opinion. So speaking of that, we'll grab that bad boy.
Looks like a torture device.
Could be.
Ooh, look at that, goes right in.
Compress that nicely. If I can find my little T-handle.
Somewhere in this mess.
This is how you know this is not scripted.
Where's the T-handle?
Sorry, everybody. I found it.
Yeah. How would you script this anyway?
I don't even know. This isn't like a professional outfit here. So.
Dirt tracks, you know?
I don't know. Yeah, I mean, you'd probably just take 100 takes and then piece them all together to get one that's smooth and doesn't make you look like an idiot. But okay, so got the spring compressed. You just want to compress this thing far enough so you can get your keepers in, so you can kind of see the groove in the end of the valve stem. And then essentially you just drop two keepers in there. So I say that, it's not quite that easy, especially when the head's up on its side like this. So what I do...
He's got a method. This is surprising. Not really, this is Doug. He's the method man.
Is
you grease them?
Yeah, use a little bit of grease on the keeper. That'll hold the first one. You can kind of put it on the bottom.
He's putting them in the grease, folks.
All right, so this is just a little something to make it sticky. Okay, so there's one. This got the grease on it, so I'm just gonna roll it around. It
turns out this intricate motor work is really tough to film.
Yeah, sorry.
That's not your fault.
Getting in your way here.
How are you getting in my way?
Okay, so there's one keeper, it's on the bottom. We'll do that same thing with the second one. You wanna pay some attention here. I mean, if you have a keeper come loose when you start the engine, that's, you know, catastrophic failure, right? It'll drop the valve, it'll hit the piston, it'll bend valves.
It's don't talk like that, Doug.
Really what you wanna do, so.
Don't talk like that. Okay, it's in there. Good shot of your wrist there. So how do you keep them in as you relieve spring pressure?
So there you go. Now they're both in there. You just kind of work this thing around. Try to keep it centered, right? So okay. it's a wedge. So you try to get that over the keepers. And once you get it started, then you just pull the spring pressure off and they'll seat themselves. But so maybe you can see that. Maybe you can't.
We'll try to zoom in.
Try to do this out of your way.
That's it?
That's it.
Nice. One down, three to go.
Yeah, so, you know, take a rag.
Okay.
Clean the grease out of there, right? Just so you can take a good look.
Make sure it's in there right.
Right. That looks really good, you know. You'll be able to tell if anything looks funny, if there's a big gap between the keepers, if one doesn't look fully seated. When you get all four of them done, just take a look, kind of make sure the end of the valve's sticking up about the same amount of length. But that's what it should look like.
Great. Nice work, bro.
There it is.
What you doing, buddy?
We're going to put a quick hone on these cylinders.
Okay.
Before we put these things together. So, you guys have been around motors at all, you know, honing a cylinder, right? Putting a little crosshatch in it, helping the ring seat, that sort of thing. Deglazing the cylinder wall. So we're just going to lightly clamp it in the vise. These are Nicosil cylinders, right? So Nicosil's really, really hard. So we're not trying to straighten the cylinder out. It's the spec. We're just trying to deglaze it a little bit, put a little bit of fresh crosshatch in it, just to let those new rings seat. Not on the Nicosil cylinder. You're not even going to get much of a crosshatch just using a lightweight hone. So what we're going to do is just use one of these flex hones, berry hones.
Dingleberry.
Dingleberry hones, you know. Lots of different names.
Is that a 4-inch?
It's a 3 3/4, so that should work nicely in that. You know, if you got a 3-stone hone, that'll work okay too. And just, like I say, knock the glaze off. So, we're gonna wipe the cylinder out real good. So you don't really wanna be rubbing dirt around in there.
Good call, good call.
So you can get in there and see, maybe you already did, I don't know. I mean, it's a good clean looking cylinder wall. There's no scoring or anything.
No, that's pretty nice.
I can tell, but there's no, you know, real visible crosshatch pattern either, so.
So I thought that you would want one that was bigger than the actual cylinder. Oh, it's bigger.
Oh, it's bigger.
So I thought this was a 3.9 inch bore. So what does that mean, 3.75? What does that mean?
No, it's not a 3.9 inch, right? It's a 92 millimeter, so, right?
Well, 92 millimeters, how big? Steve?
It's smaller than 3 3/4.
Is it really?
Do the math. Take 92, divide it by 25.4.
Oh, because 8 millimeters is definitely,
that'll tell you how
many
inches
right.
it is. I'm not doing the math in my head.
No, that's simple. 8 millimeters is bigger than a quarter of an inch.
Yep.
So that's why. Okay. Genius level.
So there's that, about to be cleaned up. So we're getting ready to hone the cylinder, which is usually just a real quick job, right? You take a little oil, whatever you got for lube, wipe it in the cylinder, you run the hone in and out. It just can't be that simple though. So Nick is dead set on making a tungsten disulfide powder slurry, and in the hopes that this powder is going to embed into the cylinder walls, reducing the friction in his cat's engine and somehow making more power.
Super secret engine mods, Doug!
So
I yelled loud as fuck there.
We're gonna do that, I guess. All right, so here's our powder.
So tungsten, that's probably enough by a lot.
Well, you
Jesus,
know.
Dude.
You wanna go fast.
Tungsten disulfide is like a nanoparticulate, right? A little bit of tungsten, a little bit of sulfur. I don't know what else is in there.
You know what it's probably going to do is just make the rings not seal at all. So it's just going to burn twice as much.
Oh, no. Would that maybe happen? Hold on. Let's think about it.
I mean it's not going to help your ring seat. That's for sure.
Oh, I hate that.
Right. Right.
Ringing in with synthetic oil.
Just pour it back in the thing.
I mean, do I really think it's... All right.
Pour it back. The residual left in that is probably somewhere $3 to $4 worth of stuff.
Yeah, that shit's expensive as hell. All right, we'll just keep that for some other use.
It was a genius-level idea foiled by common sense.
Maybe after the engine breaks in a little bit, you can just put some of that stuff in your oil.
We'll take it back apart and rehone it.
Like normal people do? All right, so a little bit of oil, all right? Whatever you got.
Ooh.
So I've even used WD-40 before.
I feel like this is kind of hot. Up to the elbow, Jesus. You've used WD-40?
Oh, yeah.
Yep. I'm not sure I would think that would be good enough.
Yep, it is, man. It's frickin' Nicosil. You're not gonna.
Oh, frickin' Nicosil.
Frickin' Nicosil. So, yeah, here we go.
So, you don't worry about getting that dingleberry hone clean. You just let it sit on the bench.
Yeah, dude. It just helps really dig those crosshatch patterns in. The dingleberry hone is clean.
Okay. It looks clean.
What else should I tell you? Don't go fast, slow, you know. Slow on the rotation, in and out pretty quickly, so you get, you know, the angle you're kind of looking for on a crosshatch. Don't put this in a two-stroke cylinder. Don't ever do that.
Why not?
They don't work.
Oh,
so well
because the exhaust
cylinder ports.
So yeah, the intake ports, right.
So here we go.
Wow, that's it?
Okay, yeah, a few rotations. See what it looks like.
Jesus, you should have seen me freaking hauling out the S10 V8 motor years back.
Yeah, right, so
I hit that thing for like an hour.
Like I said, we're not trying to straighten cylinder walls here. These cylinder walls are straight. We're just trying to deglaze, put a little pattern in them.
Oh, there's a pattern for sure.
Yep.
Let me zoom in on that pattern, show the fans.
So.
Oh yeah, that's there beautiful.
That's all we're gonna do.
That's it, really?
That's it, man. Yep.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, we're not trying to remove material. We're not trying to take a ring ridge off or take piston material off or straighten the wall. I mean, these things, you could have just bolted it back together, right? I mean, with a Nicosil bore, you're not doing that much, so.
Hmm.
A few rotations, nice and slow. That's all you need.
Nice.
Do the other one. Then when Nick gets his base gaskets that he forgot, we'll put the motor together.
So embarrassed. Thank you.